Let's talk about how the 50 states of the United States were captured in a very similar way to these island territories that nobody knows about. You say in your book that this massive expanse that was called, you know, Indian territory was really the first U.S. colony, and how that and the Louisiana Purchase defined a kind of this notion of what you called a cross-continental apartheid.
So one thing that's really important to get about the early U.S. history is how important Native American polities are to it. They are not easily displaced. And in fact, the leaders of the early republic spend a lot of time thinking about how to deal with the fact that they are ruling over a territory that they don't really have full control over, because a lot of the land still remains under Native title. And so one thing that Jefferson and those following in his footsteps try to do is they try to deal with North America, or the portion of it that's the United States, by implementing a sort of continent-scale apartheid. So Jefferson's vision, and this is what he wants to do with the Louisiana Purchase, is to use all that land claimed in the Louisiana Purchase, to use almost all of it for Native Americans. And the idea would be that the eastern part of the United States, east of the Appalachians, that part would be reserved largely for white settlers and their black slaves. And then the western part, that would be nearly all Native American lands. And in the 1830s, the United States actually did carve up a huge part of the United States into what it called Indian country. This was land that was supposed to be lived in only by Native Americans. White people without passes weren't even allowed to go there. And at the moment it was carved out of the country, Indian country accounted for 46% of the land area of the United States. So very arguably, that's the first colony that the United States ever had, a colony in the real sense. However, it didn't last very long. Indian country was a sort of fragile presence on the map, and it was quickly whittled down as more and more areas were bitten out of it and white settlers poured in, until it became what is now the state of Oklahoma.
And from the very beginning, Daniel, this wasn't a union of states. It was kind of an amalgamation of both states and territories.
Yeah, so the name of the country is the United States of America. And you might conclude from that name that it is a union of states in America. But think about what those words mean. First of all, union suggests voluntarily entered into. And a union of what? Of states. Now, it turns out that from day one, from the first day that the treaty granting the United States independence was ratified on both sides and the United States officially and legally became its own country, it wasn't just a union of states. It was an amalgam of states and territories. And that's how it was on day one. That's how it is now. And that's how it's been every day in between. There's a big difference between the Western territories, which are a large part of our history books, and the overseas territories, which are too small a part of them, I feel. But even with the Western territories, it's important to recognize that they were territories and not states, and that mattered a lot. So the process outlined by the Northwest Ordinance of 1787, by which the territories would become states, did something extraordinary. It laid out a pathway for these territories to become states, and if they became states, they would join the Union on equal footing as the other states. But it also made clear that they couldn't get statehood automatically. They'd have to go through a process. And when they started out, they would be under the sole jurisdiction of an appointed governor, basically a colonial governor, and some territorial judges. And this very small cadre of men, you know, ruled the territories like despots. I mean, there's no automatic law that people in a territory get to become a state. In order to become a state, they have to win the approval of the existing states. And there's a long history of states refusing to allow territories to become states, even when they have a population that would seem to qualify them for that.
One of the most fascinating takeaways from this book, Daniel, is kind of the predication of, white nationalism and whiteness that defined states and gave the qualifications to elevate those statuses to states. Expand more on that.
Yeah, so it's really important to recognize that white supremacy, or the rule or domination by whites, has been a really important force in U.S. history, but it hasn't just shaped lives within the United States. It's also given shape to the United States. It's decided what parts of the country become states, and it's also decided where the borders go. The prevailing logic was a logic of, do these states have a large enough white population? That's what's written into the laws that govern it, and that was the operative logic. And the reason that some territories linger in territorial status for a very long time, for example, Oklahoma, there's more than a century between the time that the majority of Oklahoma is annexed when Oklahoma becomes a state. And the reason for that is pretty transparent. The people who live in Oklahoma are, for most of this history, by and large, Native Americans. And Congress is unwilling and uninterested in admitting a state that is dominated by Native Americans.
So we only have 50 states because white people decided to colonize them the most.
Right. So, no, that's really true. The history of the statehood is the history of white settlement and the history of Congress ratifying that these areas, these territories, have enough white settlement and have enough white control to be states.
Wow, that's extremely fascinating. I mean, it's just so interesting that these states were just as captured and conquered as these other entities, but there was just enough white people to kind of validate them in that kind of cohesive logo structure that we know today.
Yeah, no, it's really easy to sort of tell a sunny story about the continental expansion of the United States, and that sunny story is about, well, this is just a republic that's full of states and it wants to make more states. And doing that, you often paper over what's involved in conquering or purchasing land, inhabited land that has French people, Spaniards, free blacks, and a lot of Native Americans on it, and then figuring out a way within the political frame of the United States to turn that land into something that fits into the political system, that fits as a state. And the magic dust that you kind of spread all over these territories in order to make them do that, that's white control.